Hi, I'm Janos, VP of Measurement at Funnel, and welcome to part 1 of 4 of this mini-series on marketing measurement. I know all the data and numbers can be overwhelming, but I promise you it's really awesome once you know it. So let's get into the first topic, marketing mix modeling, MMM. Marketing mix modeling is a statistical analysis technique used to estimate the impact of various marketing tactics online, offline performance or brand on sales performance. It helps marketers understand the effectiveness of different channels and allocate budgets more efficiently. People often mistake MMM for multi-touch attribution, MTA, but these two should not be mistaken. The key difference in comparison to multi-touch attribution is that MMM works with aggregated data and is not relying on user-level events or tracking data. That brings me to two significant benefits. First, privacy compliant by design, no personal data being used at all, therefore not GDPR relevant. Second, integration of non-trackable signals such as ad views on social media, offline marketing, non-media, non-marketing effects, for example product or price changes, events such as the CrowdStrike incidents, or macroeconomic effects such as market volatility, interest rates, and of course also brand equity. Now there are three key concepts to keep in mind with MMM. Let's run through them. First, marketing inputs, input variables, marketing channels. These include time series data such as daily spend, views or reach of different channels like TV, radio, online ads and promotions. Second, sales outputs, your target variables. The primary output is typically sales data which is analyzed to determine the impact of marketing inputs. And then third, the statistical analysis. MMM uses regression analysis and time series analysis to assess the relationship between marketing inputs and sales outputs. So how does it work? First, we start with a data collection. It starts with gathering historical data on all marketing activities and sales. This includes media spend, promotions, and other factors influencing sales. Second part is the model building. You can use regression and time series analysis to create a model that explains sales based on marketing inputs. The model identifies which activity drives sales and how much they contribute. Third, the actual optimization. Based on the model insights, you can then adjust your marketing spend to maximize return on investment. This involves reallocating budget to the most effective channels. So what are the benefits of MMM? Well, first of all, you get a holistic view on all marketing activities' impact on sales. It is not restricted to digital or trackable channels such as Google search or email, but can also include offline marketing activities such as out of home or radio ads. It also accounts for baseline effects, for example, brand equity and non-marketing and non-media effects. We already talked about price or product changes or events such as the COVID outbreak and of course macroeconomic factors such as the interest rates and changes. Second, budget allocation based on incrementality. This really helps to optimize marketing budgets by identifying the most effective channels based on incremental impact compared to the baseline. And then third, optimal scenario comparison and media planning. It enables marketers to optimize marketing budget allocation and to forecast the impact of different marketing strategies and different marketing plans. And what are the limitations of MMM? Well, first of all, MMM has a small data problem because it uses aggregated data, ideally at daily, but often at a weekly or even monthly level. This means at most 365 data points per year for each input and target variable, which can be insufficient for building really robust models. This limitation can result in two equally good MMM models based on statistical fit, but with contradicting attribution insights. For example, one model suggesting to spend more on TikTok, the others to spend less. And then second, there's a lack of actionability and granularity. Because of the small data problem that MMM has, MMMs cannot be modeled on a campaign level. But most marketers require campaign-level attribution and performance insights for operational day-to-day optimization of budget allocation. And then third, no customer journey insights. MMM operates on an aggregated data level, lagging the granularity of user-level data available in digital attribution models. This can obscure detailed customer journey insights. For example, you wouldn't be able to understand how often the retargeting ad click occurs after a specific Google search ad click. Here are some very practical considerations to keep in mind with MMM. The first one, data quality. Ensure high quality, consistent data collection across all channels, online and offline, and make sure to include major non-media effects. Second, frequent updates. Regular updates daily or at least weekly to 2, make sure that the model accounts for changes in market conditions and consumer behavior. And then 3, integration with other models. Combine MMM with digital attribution models to gain a more nuanced understanding of customer behavior and campaign performance. This also helps to make the models more robust. Marketing mix modeling is a powerful tool for understanding the effectiveness of various marketing channels and for optimizing budget allocation. However, its small data problem and reliance on aggregated data means it should be used alongside other measurement techniques for the best results. Marketeers should be aware of its limitations and use it as part of a broader measurement strategy to drive marketing effectiveness. If you like this video, subscribe so you don't miss part 2, 3 and 4, where we'll teach you about MTA, incrementality testing and triangulation. And in the meantime, check out our other videos where you'll learn more about digital marketing, marketing data and analytics, and data visualization tips and tricks. All the great content you need to shortcut your way to being a better marketer.